In Bible class one time, teacher asked the little kids, "What do you know about Jesus?" One of the little girls said, "Jesus came and was nice to everybody and they killed him." And that's what they did. He came and he taught and he healed, encouraged, warned, and they killed him. The apostles had put their hopes. And they watched as he was arrested. They watched as he was tried, supposedly. They watched as the soldiers took him and nailed him to the cross. They stood beneath the cross and they watched as he suffered. They heard the mocking. They watched him die. They observed as Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus took the body and they put it in a new tomb, in Joseph's tomb. They marked where it was because they had not been able to bury him properly. And then they went home. That must have been the longest Friday night. Saturday was the Sabbath day and they were not allowed to go and to take care of the body. I've often wondered. The Bible tells us nothing. How did they pass that long day on Saturday? What did they think about? What did they talk about? I think if it had been us, we would have been so upset and so distraught. I don't know that we would have eaten. We would have stayed awake. Till you finally, just from exhaustion on Saturday night, would have conked out. But an amazing thing takes place. Turn with me to John chapter 20. On the first day of the week, verse 1. Mary Magdalene came early to the tomb while it was still dark, and she saw the stone already taken away from the tomb. And she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other apostles. She said unto them, "They've taken away the Lord out of the tomb. We don't know where they have led him." I'm going to skip down to verse 11. And Mary was standing outside the tomb, weeping. And as she wept, she stooped and she looked into the tomb. And behold, two angels in white sitting, one at the head and one at the feet, where the body of Jesus had been laid. And they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said, "Because they've taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she said this, she turned around, and behold, Jesus standing there. She did not know it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" And she, supposing him to have been the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me, where have you laid him? And I will take him away." Jesus said, "Mary." And she turned. And she said to him, Rabbi! Can you imagine the tone of voice? The excitement? The unbelief? The belief? How do you put all of that into one word? I don't know. But that's what she did. Rabbi! She ran and she grabbed onto his feet. She was holding on for dear life. And Jesus said, stop clinging to me. I have not yet ascended to the Father, but I go to my brethren. And you say, I ascend into my Father and your Father and my God and your God. And Mary Magdalene, she came and announced to the disciples, I've seen the Lord. And the things that he had said. There's a song in our songbook. When I was first converted, I didn't like to sing. The reason I didn't like to sing, those words were not my words. Those words did not describe my relationship with God. Those words did not describe the way that I tried to walk with God. And then I discovered they weren't meant to. They weren't words about us at all. But somebody having read what we just read, they wrote this hymn describing what it was like from Mary's point of view. Rabbi! The excitement, the thrill, the faith, the hope, all of that has drastically changed. It's number 458 in our songbook. I come to the garden, or in the garden. Just going to sing the first verse, but I want you to sing this thinking of Mary. What it was like. You know, when she ran back to tell the apostles, what was going through her brain? What was she thinking about? She's running to tell the apostles, I've seen him! What was this like? And this song, it's supposed to grab that feeling that Mary had in that garden that morning when Jesus appeared unto her. No, sir, I come to the garden alone. Amazing. He walked with me and he talked with me and he called me Mary. Nobody experienced that. She was in the garden. She walked with Jesus. She knew that he was alive. Now, on another occasion, over in the book of Luke, chapter 24, Jesus, that same day, appeared unto two disciples. They left Jerusalem because he's dead. And they're going home. And Jesus appears unto them and he walks with them and he sits down and he talks with them over a meal. And he opened up the scriptures and began explaining to them that the Messiah had to die and would rise again. I wished I could have been a third person. I wished I could have sat at that table and listened to Jesus explain the scriptures. And as Jesus was showing them the scriptures, and they'd just seen the events, it says in that our hearts burned within us. I understand that. The excitement. It's true. He's not dead. He's raised. And then, in eating the bread with them,
Their eyes were opened and they recognized, this is Jesus. And you know what they did? That same hour of the night, they turned around and they left and they went back to Jerusalem because they had to tell the others. We've seen him. Don't tell me they weren't excited. They didn't have flashlights. I don't know how they walked at night. I hope it was a full moon. But it didn't matter. They were going to tell the others, and they did. And Jesus appeared unto the others, but Thomas wasn't there. And so they, with excitement, told Thomas, he's alive. We've seen this. And Thomas said, I don't believe that. Do y'all understand that? Dead people don't rise. And Jesus was dead. I don't believe that. And they said, we've seen him. Unless I see him, unless I touch him, put my hand in the nail print, I'll never believe. And Jesus appeared. And Jesus shows Thomas. And he says, come, touch me. Put your hand in my side. Feel where it was. And Thomas didn't need that now. Thomas bowed before the Lord. In John 20, verse 28, Thomas said, my Lord, my God. I don't know how to say that because it comes out as if we're swearing. And it was not swearing. It was an affirmation that Jesus is his Lord and Jesus was his God and he worshiped Jesus, the resurrected Jesus. Jesus was raised from the dead. Y'all see what was going on? Can you feel what the disciples felt? Can you feel what Mary felt? Thomas? It changed everything. And because of the resurrection, in Mark chapter 16 and verse 15, having talked about the resurrection and upbraided them that they hadn't believed it all along, he gave them the Great Commission. We call it the Great Commission. There was a smaller, lesser commission in Matthew 10, but this one was the commission unto the whole world. Go and preach the good news. We call it the gospel, but you know, sometimes I think we ought to just call it, translate it, the good news. It's not bad news that Jesus was raised from the dead. It's good news. He was dead, but he's alive. When they saw that, when they heard that, when they saw Jesus and talked with Jesus, that's good news. And they were excited. Because it changed everything about their lives. And so we told them, now, here's what you need to do. Like Mary came and shared it with you, and like you shared it with Thomas, now you go into the whole world and you tell everybody this good news. Brethren, we're not excited enough. It's become old. We become what? But they went and they began preaching. And they actually began going from town to town and city to city. And within a short time, they spread out and they went all the way to India and all the way up into Germany and all the way into England and all the way over into Africa, and they had spread in their lifetime. This message, Jesus is raised from the dead. This was the basis. And this is what they preached. In Acts chapter 2, the very first sermon. Acts 2 verse 22. you killed him. But God raised him from the dead. In Acts chapter 17, when Paul came into the city of Athens, filled with philosophers and Greek Stoics, and what he came was, he didn't come and argue philosophy with them. He preached unto them Jesus raised from the dead. And when they heard of the resurrection, they scoffed, they laughed, they ridiculed him. But some believed. I'm going to tell you, it's interesting. What do you think the difference in the emotions was between those that ridiculed and those that believed? Those that believed. I remember when I was baptized. Do you remember when you were baptized? I found it. Actually, my emotion was, whew, that's over. It's forgiven. God's not going to bring that up again. Because of the good news of the resurrection of Jesus. And so they preached it, and they preached it, and they preached it, and then they wrote about it. A couple of years ago, I had a challenge from somebody that I was trying to talk with about this, and they poo-pooed the idea of the resurrection. And I said, I'll tell you what, let's just quickly browse, read the New Testament and see how many times it gets talked about. And it got talked about in Romans, 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians. I think if I remember right, and my memory's getting old, there were two letters where it was not specifically mentioned out of 27. And even there, it was the basis of writing the letter, even though they didn't specifically talk about it. So they preached it, and they reminded the Christians, and reminded the Christians, and reminded the Christians. This is what we believe. This is at the heart of our faith. This is the heart of us being Christians. And thus it became the basis of the disciples meeting on the first day of the week. Here's a quote from a man we call Justin Martyr. He's called that because he got martyred. We only know his name. They didn't use last name, so he's Justin who got martyred. And he said, on the day called Sunday, all who live in cities or in the country gather together in one place. And the memoirs of the apostles or the writings of the prophets are read as long as time permits. Then, when the reader has ceased, the president verbally instructs and exhorts to the imitation of these good things. And then we all rise together and we pray. And as before said, when our prayers are ended, bread and wine are brought, and the president, like many, offering prayers and thanksgiving. And everyone according to his ability, the people assent and say amen. And there is distribution made unto each in a participation of that over which thanks has been given. And they who are well-to-do and willing give what each thinks is fit. And what is collected is deposited with the president, who succors the orphans and the widows and those who are through sickness or any other cause or in want, and those who are in bonds and the strangers sojourning among us, and in a word, takes care of all who are in need. But Sunday is the day in which we hold our common assembly, because it is the first day on which God, having wrought a change in the darkness and matter, made the world, and a day that Jesus Christ, our Savior, on the same day rose from the dead, for he was crucified on the day before Saturn, that is Saturday. And on the day of that of Saturn, which is the day of sun, having appeared to his apostles and his disciples, he taught them these things which we have submitted. Did y'all catch that?
This is very early in the first century. They worshiped. They knew Jesus was crucified. But they also knew that he was crucified on the day before Saturday, that is on Friday. And he was raised on the first day of the week. And he appeared unto the disciples and taught them all of these things. So on Sunday, which Sunday? Do y'all realize how language gets used? Sunday. Not the third Sunday. Not the fourth Sunday. Not every other Sunday. Sunday. And on Sunday, we all gather together and we read Scripture. How long? Well, we keep reading as long as time permits. I love that church. And then what? Well, then they preach to us from what we've read. And they exhort us, now go do what you just heard. Go be what you just read. Put into practice the teaching that we have had. And then we all gather together and we begin praying. And many prayers get made. And then we bring the bread, the wine. Now, what he actually said was wine mixed with water, because the wine needed to be. And this was their normal way of serving wine. But be that as it will, they had the Lord's Supper. When? Sunday. Which Sunday? Sunday. And when they had the Lord's Supper, they then took up a contribution among them to take care of the needs of the people that were there. And what we read in the New Testament is a really shortened version of that. When Paul came to Troas in Acts 20 and verse 7, it says, upon the first day of the... Y'all know when that day is? Sunday. Which Sunday? On Sunday, the disciples came together. That's purpose. They came together to break bread. And guess what Paul did? He preached unto them. How long did he preach? Until one of them fell asleep and fell out the window, and then he kept preaching. Exhorting them, encouraging. Brethren, this was the early church. It was built upon the resurrection. And their faith was so adamant on that. And thus the Lord's Supper, which we partake of, is based not just on the death and the burial of Jesus. If that was true, he's just a dead Jew. But he's not. He's not here. He's risen. They worshiped a resurrected Messiah. In honor of him, they came together and came together and came together, and they worshiped and they prayed and they gave and they read. This was their life. And this was the basis of baptism. In Romans chapter 6, we were buried with Christ in baptism. That like as Christ was raised, we were raised to walk in newness of life. So even our conversion and our worship, it's all built on the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Wow. The resurrection changes everything until you live in England. A recent poll was done. Now, I studied sociology, and I'm going to tell you, I shake my head when I read polls.
Who did they ask? How did they ask it? What questions did they ask? All of that's pertinent. So I don't know the accuracy of all of the numbers, but here's, even if it's only close, a fourth of those that said they were Christians did not believe in the resurrection. Really? Two-thirds said, well, I kind of believe in the resurrection, but not the way it's told in the Bible. Can't believe all that stuff. And then again, 43% who attended regularly. Now, I don't know what the difference between that 25% above and this group is. It depends on who they were asking and what they did. But this is astounding. Those that would attend regularly to church services, 43% don't believe in the resurrection? Actually, what they said was 57% who attend regularly believe it. I went, whoa. And you know what the Bishop of England said? This was astounding. This is important, and Welcome Survey proves that many British people, despite not being regular churchgoers, hold on to Christian beliefs. Now, I want to back up. 25% don't believe anything of it? 43% that attend all the time don't believe in it? Two-thirds don't believe the way that it was written? And this is good news? Really? I'm going to tell you what. America is not far behind. When we talk about what the resurrection means, I don't know whether you've been watching TV this week or not. I'm always going to the selection that gives you what you can watch, because I'm always trying to find something worth watching. You know, you scroll and you go day after day looking for this. And the one thing that I've always noticed this time of year, and usually around December 20th, there are show after show after show debunking the idea of Christianity. But I'm not one of those. I'm one that believes. I believe Jesus was raised from the dead. I believe that Mary fell before him and grabbed onto his feet. I believe that Thomas bowed before him and said, "My Lord and my God." I believe that they went everywhere preaching the resurrection. Every book of the Bible, as they said that, that's what we believe. And because of that, it begins to change everything about our lives. I have two wishes, and they can't both be true. I wished you would have known me before I became a Christian. But I'm also glad, and I wished everybody could understand why I'm a Christian now. And the change. And the truth is simply this. The resurrection of Jesus changes everything. Your purpose, your existence, your life, how you live, where you go, who you... It changes. There is a God. Do you all realize resurrections don't happen without God? But put God in the picture. And Paul said, why would you find it remarkable that the dead rise? You believe in God. You know what people's problems are? They really don't believe in God. When they talk about the resurrection couldn't happen, the resurrection didn't happen, they don't believe in God. But with the resurrection of Jesus, it changes things. There is a God. In Romans chapter 1, he was declared with power to be the Son of God by the resurrection from the dead. When he was arrested, the high priest said, "Tell us, are you the Son of the Blessed One?" "I am." And they went crazy. They tore their robes. They picked up dirt and threw it in the air. They were out of control. He claimed to be the Son of God. "Kill him." And they drug him out and they killed him. And they ridiculed him. "You said you're the Son of God. Come down." He said he could save everybody. "Save yourself." And on the first day of the week, he's alive. He is the Son of God. With power, he's declared to be the Son of God. Paul said in Romans chapter 14, "To this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and the living." The very first sermon Peter ended in Acts 2, he says, "Let all of Israel know that God hath made the same Jesus whom you crucified to be Lord and Christ." The resurrection changes everything. Believers are baptized and raised to walk in newness of life. But we're baptized into Christ. And as Christ was raised, so we are raised. It changes everything. We were dead in sins, and now I'm alive unto God. I was guilty and deserved wrath, and God forgave and made me alive. The resurrection, it changes everything. It gives hope at funerals. There was a man, lived back in the 1800s, debated Alexander Campbell, for those who like to keep track of certain things. He didn't believe in God. He didn't believe in resurrection. He didn't believe in the Bible. He didn't believe in Christianity. When you're dead, you're like Rover. You're dead all over. And his brother died. And they got in touch with him, and he went and they had a funeral. And standing at the brother's graveside, now, you know, they did things different back then. As you stood around the graveside, they lowered the casket down into the hole. Looking down at the grave that is about to be covered up and walked away from, with his brother's body inside the casket. Here's what he said. "Please don't ask him or anybody like him to preach my funeral." Because here's what he said. "Life, it's a narrow veil between cold and barren peaks of two eternities. We strive in vain to look beyond the heights. We cry aloud, and the only murmur is the echo of our wailing cry. From voiceless lips of the unreplying dead, there comes no word. But in the night of death, hope sees a star, and listening love can..." What? There's no hope. But there is. As Jesus was raised, he has promised to come back and to raise us. And Paul said in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, "I would not have you to sorrow like the rest of them sorrow." For we have hope. This Jesus is coming again. That means he died, was buried, and ascended back up into heaven, and he's coming again. And those that are dead in Christ, it won't be lifeless, wordless lips. They will rise. Hallelujah. What are they going to say when they rise? What's that going to be like? What are you going to think? What are you going to say? Thousands of believers arise and ascending, and Jesus appears, and everybody can see he is here. He is risen. And then we get to go. And we join them. And together, we're ushered into the very presence of God. And there we get to live forever and ever. No darkness, no night, no sorrow, no death, no pain, no suffering. Please don't ask Ingersoll to preach my funeral. In fact, I'll tell you what, you don't have to preach a funeral at all, just have a party. But in your party, make it godly and rejoice and talk about Jesus and talk about the hope and the coming and our gathering together. The resurrection of Jesus changes everything, including our death. And they went from death, sorrow, despair, doubt, to faith. Faith in God and faith in Jesus. Realization. The resurrection of Jesus Christ changes everything about us. Has it changed your life? On Sunday, not on one Sunday a year, not one Sunday a month, not every third month, on Sunday. God's people gather and we worship God because Jesus is raised from the dead. Shout it from the roofs. Post it on Facebook. Put it on Twitter. Tattoo it on your forehead. Jesus is raised from the dead. Preach this good news unto every creature. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved. That can be you this morning. Has it changed your life? We will bury you like as Christ was buried, and we will raise you like Christ was raised, and you can walk in newness of life because everything is new and different and wonderful. If you're willing to do that, we invite you to come. Confess your faith. We'll baptize you right now. As together we stand and sing, we invite you to come.